I've greatly improved the CPU I designed in my previous video, Testing and Improving My CPU Design with Logisim. Refer to that video for a detailed description of how this CPU works and the digital logic basics used to implement it. This video will focus more on using the CPU in a full-fledged computer with device I/O including keyboard, terminal screen, video screen, and audio. The first improvement was to upgrade the CPU to a 32-bit design. As I stated in my previous video, the CPU was originally designed to be 20-bit, but I made it 8-bit to make it easier to implement in Logisim. Now it's 32-bit, with the Z register now being 24 bits, and the opcode portion of the instruction being 8 bits. This allows for the capability of 256 instructions. So the next improvement was to add a lot of instructions to make the CPU more versatile. Here's the entire instruction set. The first 16 instructions are from the original design. I no longer take over no-op to trigger a flip-flop to switch between add and subtract and multiply and divide, since I now have plenty of instruction slots. And I can now have a repeatable kit effect, since I now have instructions to compare the register to any value. The next change was replacing the control logic, which was a bunch of ORs, with a ROM encoded with all the control lines. ROM address 0 corresponds to opcode 0, address 1 corresponds to opcode 1, etc. This isn't exactly an improvement to the CPU design, but it does allow for the instruction set to be added to or modified in a much easier fashion, and also doesn't take up as much space. If this CPU was to be made into an integrated circuit, one would probably want to change the ROM back to a set of ORs. The next improvement was to move the RAM and LEDs to the main circuit and have the CPU be a sub-circuit. This allows much more room for I/O devices. With the increase in instruction space, the ALU could be improved, adding logic functions. And there's also a compare sub-circuit used for the conditional branches. The gaps in the mucks are there because originally the new compare functions were part of the ALU, but I decided to take them out of the ALU and put them in a separate sub-circuit. Also, the A register is now more useful. In fact, it is required for the compare sub-circuit. Back to the main circuit. The I/O devices are controlled by this decoder. The most significant bit of the address bus, if set, signifies that the memory write should go to the devices rather than the RAM. The least significant bits select and control the devices, TTY terminal screen, video screen, keyboard, sound buzzer, and LED matrix display in that order. I modified the source code of Cornell's video screen component to give it higher resolution and better color. It looks the same size, but that's misleading since theirs is 127 by 127 pixels, with each pixel's width and height double size. The trade-off, of course, is my version is slower since there are many more pixels to set and render. I also put in an RGB LED to indicate the CPU's state, red for halted, green for running, and yellow for executing an instruction. I also put in a dip switch to turn on and off the various value displays. Both the RGB LED and the dip switch come from Logisim Evolution. I modified the source code in order to compile them to run in this version of Logisim. I don't like Logisim Evolution's ridiculously gigantic counters, RAM, and ROM. Also, circuits created in this version aren't fully compatible with Logisim Evolution, so I grabbed the parts of Evolution I needed instead. I also added a new parameter to the dip switch, the ability to specify the switch setting here. And here's the sound buzzer circuitry. So let's run a program. Let's select the ubiquitous Hello World. By the way, here's the LED matrix driver subcircuit. If you don't like the lag in the row updates, here's the solution. another set of registers that only update once all the rows are in. Now the kit or Cylon effect. It's fully repeatable now. And the running lights version. Let's jump to the five tones. Now the video displays. I'll have to time-lapse these, since it would take too long to render. The highest clock rate Logisim supports is 4.1 kHz, and that rate is only achievable if your computer that is running Logisim is fast enough. By comparison, the Commodore VIC-20 was 1 MHz. The original IBM XTs were 4.77 MHz, and the original Commodore Amiga was 7.16 MHz. And those are left in the dust by today's gigahertz computers. So a 4.1 kHz clock is not going to be a speed demon. This is my modified video screen, which is 256 by 256 with 24-bit color. Here's my logo. Here's a flower I photographed. Here's a version using Cornell's original 127 by 127 with 15-bit color screen. And since 256 by 256 doesn't have a really useful screen aspect ratio, I created a free 20 by 240 version. Here's the gallery scene in this mode. Since free 20 doesn't fall on a power of 2 boundary, I chose to use a different method of addressing each pixel. The X counter counts to free 19, and when it increments past free 19, it goes back to 0 and increments the Y counter. I decided to write an assembler for this CPU to make it easier to write programs for it. Here's the program you just saw running. It's more than just this, since those includes bring in the images and the LED matrix message. I put in various assembler directives to make life easier. Some of them are similar to 68,000 assemblers, but only very loosely similar. Here's an example program to test some of those directives. I guess other than the triggering problem I mentioned in my previous video, which did creep up again during the development of this version, I would say the hardest part is knowing when to stop. At some point you have to say, there's enough instructions, enough devices, etc. Maybe my next step is to create my own Logisim Java component libraries from scratch, rather than modify someone else's. I did think of doing a sound component, but someone already made one, which is the one I used in this circuit. We'll see what comes next. I was just about to upload this video when I thought of a Java library component I could create. It's a real-time clock. I put in parameters to set 12 or 24 hour format and time zone. By the way, just as with the RGB LED and the dip switch, I ported the BCD to 7th segment and the bin to BCD components from Logisim Evolution. The running program just grabs the clock value and sends it to the Y register via the data in instruction. Here's the program. Forgot to mention, I wrote a program to make calculating the control ROM easier. I started out doing it in my head, but the more control lines, the harder that was to do.